Sure, I say good evening. And thank you for tuning in to those that are in that virtual sanctuary, giving those opportunity to come on, those that are in our, on our Zoom platform. We do apologize for the inconvenience on tonight as the information expires, so we needed to update that. So remember, know we may have some that typically join via Zoom that may drop in a little bit on the later end or a little bit later than usual, which is okay. But we want to make sure that everyone does have opportunity to log on. So again, we say good evening to each and every one of you, and thank God for what He has done, His grace and His mercy, which is sufficient for us. We thank Him for another day that He has kept us. Amen. Another day that He has made, and certainly we have already been rejoicing and glad in what He has done. At this time, we're going to begin with prayer. We're going to begin with prayer. So if you would join us as we go to God in prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, before we ask you for anything, we want to take the time to thank you for everything. We thank you for life, and for health, and for strength. Realizing, God, it's in you that we live, it's in you that we move, it's in you that we have our being. And Father, we pause to say thank you. Thank you for this opportunity that you have afforded to us to come and to share, to glean from your word. And God, we know that your word is a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our pathway. We ask the Lord that you would help us to hide our word, hide your word in our hearts, that we might not sin against you. We pray the Lord that we do your word no harm, but that you be pleased with everything that we say and do. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Again, we thank God for each and every one of you. We want to say, especially to all of our veterans, happy Veterans Day. We salute you to all that have served in whatever branch of military that you may have served in. We salute you on this evening. Thank you for what you have done to defend, protect, and to ensure life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness for all. And so we thank you to all that served in whatever branch of military that you possibly may have served in. We salute you on tonight. Tonight we want to start a new subject, a new series. Amen. We want to go, we'll finish what we talked about, deception, a few weeks ago, and the power of deception and how deception is a real thing. Deception is not a figment of imagination, but it is real. And unfortunately, many have been tossed and driven. Many have succumbed to deception because deception, excuse me, is seductive in that which we say deception does not always come as dressed as false truths. It does not always come looking like it is a lie, but deception is sometimes embellished to make it appear that it is true. And so we want to make sure that we keep our lures going, our loins girded with truth. We want to make sure that we keep our feet planted on the Word of God, knowing that everything else is going to pass away, but the Word of God shall stand forever. So on tonight, let's go to St. John, the 15th chapter. St. John, the 15th chapter. St. John, the 15th chapter. And this is a very familiar passage of scripture for some, and for others it may not be as familiar, but certainly we hope that after our time that we shall have spent together on tonight, that it will be somewhat familiar to you at that point in time. So St. John, the 15th chapter, and we're going to be reading in your hearing on tonight from the King James Version. Beginning at the first verse, St. John, the 15th chapter, the gospel as it is recorded by John, chapter number 15, beginning at verse 1. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word, now which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can ye accept ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. For men abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit. So shall ye be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love. You see this phrase here, abiding. So he says, if you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this in the land, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth, I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you friends. For all the things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. Ye have not, let me take number 8 down. Ye have not chosen me. Thank you. But I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, that ye love one another. If the world hate me, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. We're going to pause and stop right there, 18th verse. May the Lord have a blessing to his holy red word, and certainly this is the word of God, the people of God. Thanks be unto God. All right, so tonight we want to talk about simply, thank you, abiding in Christ. Abiding in Christ. Nothing deep, nothing prolific, if you will, as far as it's the subject is concerned, but certainly the content is very prolific. Abiding in Christ. Now, in order for us to understand what we're going to discuss, we must first understand what it means to abide. What does it mean to abide? If we look up that literally, we understand to abide means to accept or act in accordance with a rule, a decision, or recommendation. It's also to be unable to tolerate something or someone. All right? If we look, so therefore, abiding also means to remain stable or fixed in a state, a love that abided with him all his days. That's one example. To continue in a place and to continue and remain steadfast in a place. To conform to a certain direction or rules, to accept without objection. So when we talk about abiding in Christ, this is definitely something worth having a discussion about. And if you look at John's Gospel in the 15th chapter, there's something that I think is very noteworthy for us to understand, that if you have a Bible in which does show you the sayings of Christ and that which is not specifically stated directly from the mouth of Christ, you will understand that, or you will see that these words should be in red. All right? So when you look at your Bible, you will see that the 15th chapter of St. John is entirely in red, which helps us to understand that these are the words directly from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, the vineyard was a staple of agriculture in the ancient world. All right? The fruit thereby produced became a source of substance year-round, with many of the harvested grapes being converted into raisins and wine for later consumption. All right? One of the enticing descriptions of the Promised Land was its productive vineyards. Indeed, a physical sign brought back by the ill-fated spying expedition into the promised land, was a massive cluster of grapes. Vineyards were a common sight throughout Galilee, Samaria, and Judea. And so why does Christ use this terminology? Well, obviously, if you understand Jesus, he certainly always used in his speech, in his vernacular, things that the believers, those that he was trying to convey the message to, he used terms, things that they could understand. And so vineyards were nothing new, vineyards were nothing common, but they were a common sight throughout the land, Galilee, Samaria, and Judea in Jesus' day. Beside the text that we're reading today, he also used a vineyard imagery in his parables of the workers in the vineyard, according to Matthew 20, 1 through 16. All right. Also, the two sons, we hear, according to Matthew 21, 28 through 32, we see therein reference as it relates to the vineyard. Also to the wicked tenants in Matthew 21, verses 33 through 39. And the barren fig tree in Luke 13, 6 through 9. So when we look at the scripture, vineyards is nothing new. It is nothing uncommon. It was something prevalent during that time. And so when you look at the teachings of Christ, Christ always, amen, he always wanted those in which, and Christ did not just come teaching and preaching and witnessing to the believers, but also to the non-believers. He came to spread this message, and he came to promote love, to promote unity. Amen, that's the whole message of Jesus Christ. So when we understand what vineyards, the relevance as to the scripture, vineyards was something very common. And so how it is not unusual in this text. We should find it not unusual that he used this as a reference point. All right. Now, some students consider today's, or this, the text that we have reviewed or will review on tonight, also to be a parable. What is a parable? A parable is an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. So Jesus will take something that we could, that we would see every day of our lives, and use it to convey that which relates to the heavens. All right. So Jesus, being infinite, being wise, being who he was, God in flesh, he would use parables which would allow you to take things that you would see, such as chairs, such as cars, but the things that we are able to relate to. Amen. He would use that to convey to us the message about the kingdom of heaven. All right, some consider the text to be a parable. A parable is better thought of as an illustrative comparison or an extended metaphor without a plot. Everything depends on the definition of parable. Common experiences regarding vineyards also assumed in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7. Grapevines would be pruned. Now, we're just laying the foundation as we talk about abiding in Christ. Grapevines would be pruned severely at a certain time of the year, leaving little more than a leafless, branchless stump that would be propped up with a rock or two. All old branches would be cut off and carried away, providing valuable fuel for home fires. If you understand how they did in that time, the grapevines would be pruned, and they would not prune them just to in a few or in a very a way in which you had no regard. But when grapevines were pruned, they were pruned aggressively. They were pruned severely because they did not want to stunt the growth of that vine. But that which was cut off, the old branches, that which bear no fruit, that which would damage the vine, would be carried away and provided valuable for fuel for the homes. And so, in other words, they would be we're really not doing the kingdom of God in good. Because when you do not bear fruit, the whole reason for us becoming believers in Christ Jesus is not to talk about how long we've been saved, not to talk about how long we've been Holy Ghost filled, not to talk about how long we've been speaking in tongues, not talk about how long we've been paying our tithes, not talk about how long we've been living here or living there, but the whole goal for every believer is to bear fruit. Amen. After new branches have grown, a second pruning would occur to remove the smaller branches. And this allowed the larger branches to produce bigger clusters of larger grapes. And such pruning was part of the process known as cultivating the vines. And you'll see that in Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 39. And so on tonight, we see here in the text that this Jesus makes or calls us to understand who we are in Him. He introduces the text in a very, I think, in a very clear way to help us understand what is our place as it relates to our walk with Christ. All right, tonight's lesson is a section in the Gospel of John known as the farewell disclosures, or the upper room disclosures. John chapters 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17 are known as the farewell disclosures. So now we see that Jesus is beginning to do some teaching because he realizes, amen, that he has to go away. Amen. He told them in the previous chapter, chapter 14, he helped them to know, amen, that he had to go away, amen, and that the Comforter would come. So when you look at John chapter 13, 14, 15, and 17, we would understand this to be the upper room disclosure. These are the farewell disclosures of what Jesus would have the disciples to know. These consist of Jesus' teaching on the night before his crucifixion as he spent time with his disciples. Now think about this. Think about this. Anytime you find a person that knows they're going to die, I'm not talking about, we all know that unless we be raptured, we're going to die. Amen. There's only two ways you can get out of here. That's either by death or rapture. Now, typically speaking, when someone dies, amen, someone of sound mind, someone that is of, decent thought process, he or she on their deathbed will talk about things that are valuable to them. Many times it's customary when someone is transitioning, family comes in and that loved one will let them know how they will love for things to go, how they want to be buried, how they want the family to continue on, and things of that nature. They will begin to talk about who they want to give, you know, this, that, and the other to. Typically speaking, those that are know that they're dying, amen, their last moments are very important. Why? Because it is during this time that they convey to those that are around them, to those that will listen and those that will hear, they convey to them what is most important. And so if we understand that to be so, we will really give much consideration to these chapters, chapter 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17, because these are the chapters, amen, that take place before, amen, Christ will be, amen, go into the next level in which he was crucified. And so, in other words, we go back and understand, this took place prior to the crucifixion, the night before the crucifixion. And so what this helps us to understand is that if Christ talked about this, amen, knowing that his death was pending, knowing that his death was near, we should give much thought and consideration to what we see here. It was a time of solemn Passover observance with friends. The result was a rich deposit of Jesus' teaching that is invaluable for our spiritual health today. Mark chapter 14 and Luke chapter 22. Mark 14 and 15 to be more specific, and Luke chapter 22 and verse 12. And I hope, amen, that as we throw these scriptures out, we're not just throwing them out just throwing out scripture, but these are for us to meditate on. Amen. Go back and read and give much consideration to. Mark chapter 14 and 15 and Luke chapter 22 and 12 are the sources of the designation upper room. Most of Jesus' teaching in this location is found primarily in the Gospel of John. Now notice what he says. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. His Father is the vine dresser. Jesus uses this imagery of a vineyard as a familiar context for the vital, important teaching that he is to offer. From the outset, there is no doubt regarding who the imagery represents. In referring to himself as the true vine, amen. He said that I am the true vine. In other words, there are some vines out there, amen, that are not true. There are some things out there that are not true. Don't you know Jesus did not just say true vine just to be said? Because Jesus never throws out words just to be using labels. But he throws out words with a clear intention. And so let's help us understand that true vine. Help us understand there were some vines. There were, and we're not talking about in the natural. Those were down in the spiritual. There were some vines. There were some persons out there that were not authentic. They were not genuine. They were not true. And so Jesus said, I am the true vine. He affirms that he is the one chosen by God for the task set forth in John chapter 3 through 6, chapter 3 verse 16, where it says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And God sent his Son in the world to not condemn the world, but the world through him. The world through him might be saved. So in other words, we understand that Christ came, amen, his whole reason to come, amen, was for us to not just receive him as Lord and Savior, but for us to abide in him, for us to stay with him. It does not do you any good to get saved and don't stay with Jesus. Amen. So God wants us to build, amen, our relationship with him should be built. David is kind of like a recipe. Amen. You put the ingredients in for the outcome. Whatever you're going to cook, whatever you're going to bake, you put the ingredients. In order to have, amen, a good cake, you got to have the right kind of sugar, the right kind of eggs, and the right kind of flour, and this, that, and the other. Such as it is in the spirit. If we're going to have a good relationship with Christ, then we got to have the right ingredients, amen, that goes into this thing. So we got to have certain principles, amen, that is not open for discussion. And if someone is going to bake a cake, will not argue with you as to whether or not the cake needs flour or eggs, simply because it is a known fact that the cake needs eggs and flour. As it is in the natural, so it is in the spiritual. As it relates to our walk with Christ, there are certain things that are not open for discussion. It's either God's principle, it's either God's way, or no way at all. There are no shortcuts, amen, to being in a true, in a genuine, in an authentic relationship with Christ. And many people know him surfacely. Many people know him because of what they heard, mama and grandma and auntie and cousin, or what the preacher has said. Amen. But God is not looking for, and he does not desire for us to be surface believers. Amen. He wants us to go beneath the surface. Amen. You ought to know something about Jesus, not because of what someone told you, but because you spent time with him. And so the whole goal of our walk with Christ is not just to get saved. Amen. Because there's work to do after you get saved. Now, if you die on if you're in no better position, then you get saved then, amen. Then of course, then you go on, amen. Then there's no work to be done. But if you are alive, amen, even if you are on no better position, amen, you can still do some work from the bed. Amen. So the reality is our relationship with Christ, abiding in him, is a daily routine. Amen. So as I said earlier, as it relates to baking the cake, it's not open for discussion as to what ingredients it takes to make. more people ain't following. Amen. That does not make it gospel. But many people will flock to, amen, what they want to hear. We talk about that as it relates to deception. It is not about what we want to hear, but it's about what we need to hear. The Bible says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And this book, the 66 books of the Bible, is hard sometimes for us to digest. But if we are to abide in him, if we're going to stay with him, if we're going to conform and make what God says be true, if we're going to obey him, amen, if we're going to serve him, if we're going to do what God would have us to do, then there are certain things that are not open for discussion. And so Jesus helps us to know, amen, he identifies that he is the true vine. There is no falseness in him. Amen. There's nothing in him that is fabricated. He is the only begotten Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. But he goes on to say, and my Father is the husbandman. He is the vine dresser. All right? This was a familiar symbol that we already discussed. This vine, this symbolism was familiar. God repeatedly used the vine as a symbol of his people in the Hebrew scripture. If you go back and read Psalms 80, verses 8 through 9, you'll see there also that usage used, or that imagery used, and that symbolism used in that passage of scripture. Yet it was often used in a negative sense. In Isaiah 5, verses 1 through 2, and verse 7, and Jeremiah 2 and verse 21. Just in the previous text, previous to chapter 15, Jesus publicly talked about Israel being like a vineyard in the parable of the vineyard. Go back and look at Matthew chapter 21, verses 33 through 34. Jesus spoke to his disciples probably as they stood in the upper room and prepared to leave. He used the picture of vine because there were grapevines everywhere in that day. Also, there was a large golden vine set as a prominent decoration on the front of the temple, communicating the idea that Israel was God's vine. As well, the vine was a recognized symbol also of the Messiah. In contrast, Jesus is the true vine. Amen. He is not something that we just put on front of a door, but he is the truth. Those things were symbols. The vines that you have, amen, in your kitchen. I mean, vines that you may have in your home are just symbolic. But Jesus says, I am not a symbol, I am the true vine. I am not a replicant. Amen. I am not some kind of copy. Don't you know every vine that you see, Jesus is not a copy of it. It's fine to be a copy of him. He says that he is the true vine. We must be rooted in him, not in our own belief, not in what we know, because sometimes, and we must say our own belief, because sometimes what we believe is what we want to believe. And sometimes what we believe is, is stagnated because we don't want to go up in our faith. But our true steadfastness in him must be rooted in who he is. If we bear fruit for God in the new covenant community, our first identification in Jesus Christ himself, not in Israel or not in a church. Now notice here, this is very prolific. He says that I am the true vine, not Oak Grove, amen, not Baptist, not Apex, not Cobb, but I am the true vine. And so we cannot be hung up. It's good to have, amen, come from good stock. It's good to, to recognize and represent where you come from. It's good to be proud of the church in which your name is on. Amen. But never become so haunted in what your name is. Amen. That you forget about where your name needs to be. And that's a lamb. That's in the Lamb Book of Life. So Jesus helps us understand that true relationship in him is not rooted in a place, a physical location, but it is rooted
rooted in the fact of who he is. And so this is why we must really understand what this is helping us to know. It's because the fact of that is, some of us have surface religion. In other words, some of us have a surface relationship. So as long as I'm in the church, amen, I know who he is. As long as I sit on my favorite pew, I know who he is. But God wants us to go beyond surface relationship and really get down deep, become deeply rooted in him. Amen. When we become deeply rooted in him, we realize it's not about place. It's not about, amen. This is why we don't boast or brag about, amen, my church is better than yours. Amen. Because at the end of the day, no matter what your name is, amen, as far as a church building is concerned, we think God for churches. Amen. But what Christ was coming to help us understand, and this is why Christ really upset a whole lot of people, is because a lot of people were conformed and connected and tied to the order of the day. And so, what are you trying to say? Is some people use the wrong things to identify themselves. But every believer, every true believer, must seek their identification in the vine. Jesus is the true vine. We must be rooted in him. Amen. If we want to bear fruit for God, of many pictures of the relationship, amen, between God and his people, the vine and the branch, picture emphasizes complete dependence and need for constant connection. You cannot have the branch without the vine. The branch depends on the vine even more than the sheep depends on the shepherd, or the child depends on the father. Let me say it again. You cannot have branches, amen, except you have a vine. And this is why I don't really understand how people profess to be in Christ, but are not connected to the vine. The branch depends on the vine for nourishment. The branch depends on the vine for rejuvenation. The branch depends on the vine, amen, to be revitalized. Amen. The branch depends on the vine. Amen. To be able to go a little bit further. Amen. Even as the sheep depends on the shepherd, the vine depends on the branches depend on the vine even more than that. Amen. Children depend on their parents. Very much so. But the branch depends on the vine even more than that. Amen. Because your parents can leave you. Your parents may leave this world. They may walk out and never raise you up, but you can still make it. But brothers and sisters, if you ever become disconnected from the vine, you cannot make it. As Jesus was about to depart from his disciples, this was very important encouragement. He will remain united to them, and they to him, as truly as branches are connected to the main vine. He said that his father is the husband. His father is the vine dresser. In the Old Testament, the use of the vine as a picture of Israel. God the Father was also present as the one who cultivated and managed the vine. God fulfilled the role also for the believer under the new covenant. The new covenant participant has relationship with both the Father and the Son, with both the vine itself and the vine dresser. Let me say it again. The new covenant participation has relationship with both the Father and the Son, with both the vine and the vine. You cannot be connected to the vine and not have any, amen. There's no way for you to say, I'm connected to the vine, amen, but not having a connection to the vine dresser. You cannot be connected to the vine dresser and not be connected to the vine. Jesus said, I am the true vine, but my Father is the husbandman. He is the vine dresser. He is the one who cultivates and manages the vine. Amen. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, in verse number 2, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, every branch, so this lets us know, because he presents this to us, is it possible for you to be connected to Jesus and not bear fruit? Certainly, that's not God's will for your life. But some people, amen, that just think that it's all about just getting saved and nothing else, they are fruitless. But this is what Jesus has to say about them. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Amen. So Jesus helps us to know, amen, you can be connected to me, amen, but if you're connected to me, either one or two things are going to happen. Either you're going to be purged, that you may bring forth more fruit, or either you're going to be cut off because you are fruitless. Amen. And so this is why I cannot really study, amen, and sit there and spend so much time looking at you, because I'm trying to work, amen, to get my own fruit on my own tree. My fruit may not look like your fruit, but all of us ought to be bearing some fruit. The branches that are taken away were nearly properly abiding. The branches that are taken away were never, rather, properly abiding in the vine, demonstrated by the fact that they did not bear much fruit. So let me tell you something. Is it possible for you to come into contact with who Jesus is, amen, and not bear fruit? Certainly, that is a possibility, but it is not God's will for your life. But when you become connected in him, and you really seek to do the will of the Father, you're going to bear fruit. And then this is why we cannot live and be in this day and time and be fruitless. And we got a lot of fruitless people. And then when you look at them, and then the only thing that's left is back in 1970, I got saved. Honey, what has taken place between 1970 and 2020? Here we are, amen, 40, 50 years later, and you still talk about something that happened and then in the other century. Get over what happened last century. God said, what have you accomplished? What have you done? Have you grown and matured? And then since you got saved, amen. Let me tell you something. It does not matter how long you've been saved. If you have not done anything since you first got saved, let's say it again. It does not matter how long you've been saved. This is why it don't be any good to talk about, you know, honey, child, I've been in Christ for, you know, about 60 years, and putting down someone else that just came into the knowledge of Jesus Christ. God is not concerned how long you've been saved, but what have you done since you've been saved? Because don't you know that you can be saved and be fruitless? Amen. God does not want us to be fruitless Christians. And then he wants us to be fruitful. Amen. Have you reached anybody since you've been saved? Have you witnessed to anybody since you've been saved? You mean to tell me you've been saved all these years and you never witnessed to anybody in your family? Amen. Well, they'll get saved. Just, I mean, don't you know God saved you so that you can help somebody else? And that's what Christianity is all about. Amen. If you're in a family where you got unsaved loved ones, that's where the work is. Amen. We cannot wait to get to God's house and then trying to accomplish this, that, and the other. But charity starts at home and then it spreads abroad. Amen. So our desire is, as we become closer and closer to Christ, is that everybody that we know, amen, even those that we don't know, amen, but those that I know especially, that they come into contact and they come into the knowledge of who Jesus is. I cannot walk about and I cannot walk carefree around loved ones that I know that are not saved. They need to know, amen, that there is a risen Savior. They need to know, amen, that Jesus died for their sins. They need to know, regardless of what they've done in their life, that Jesus can still save you. How many people have you witnessed to, amen, with all this calamity in 2020? How many people have you talked to, amen, about the good news of Jesus Christ? Do you wait, amen, until you get onto the Zoom call? Do you wait until you log into Facebook Live? Do you wait until you look into the YouTube? Amen. But are you witnessing on your job? Are you witnessing at the breakfast table? Somebody ought to be talking about the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen. So I don't wait till I get to a certain place. Amen. This is what Jesus was trying to help us say. The vine being connected to the vine was not a specific place. Amen. Even though Israel was viewed, amen, as the branches, he was helping them to understand that I am the true vine. In other words, amen, if I leave Israel, if I leave North Carolina, amen, I'm always connected. Why? Because I'm connected to the true vine. Amen. So we're living in a time where the word of God is as precious like like never before. And everybody needs to come into a saving knowledge of who Jesus is. Don't you know that you may be the only Bible that your brother, your sister, your cousin, your niece, or nephew may read? There's one question that we must ask ourselves. If you are the only Bible that your cousin, your sister, your brother, your co-worker may read, can they say that they see Jesus in you? Can they say, amen, that the way that you talk, they see the love of Christ? Can they say the way that you treat people? Amen. You can't come into God's house and shout on the church. Amen. And then when you do the job, amen, you keep up ruckus and confusion. The Bible says that he is like the author of confusion. But Jesus is the Prince of Peace. And so if Jesus is the Prince of Peace, amen, then if I'm connected to the vine, if I'm connected to the true vine, then wherever I go as a branch, I ought to take some peace with me. I ought not be bringing confusion. I mean, I ought not be bringing comfort. I ought not be bringing those things that are not pleasing in the lifestyle of God when people see you coming. Do they say that's a sin of God? Do they say that's a person that loves the Lord? Or are they running the other way because they know you say one thing and you do another? Don't you know that people know, amen, even unsaved folks can tell when you're real and when you're not? Amen. This is why, amen, we cannot afford really to be taken, amen, any type of luxury in our mind. We cannot take luxury vacations and clock out and relate to our walk with Christ. Amen. Because when you are connected to the vine, when you are really rooted and grounded in Him, we have no days off. Every day you're saved. Every day you're a recruiter for Christ. Every day you are a believer. Since when do you take time? Well, I don't feel like witnessing to nobody today. Honey, every day you get up, you better be ready to witness to somebody about the good news of Jesus Christ. Why? Because somebody witnessed to you. Amen. And so Jesus says that He is the vine. Amen. That we are the branches. But He's the true vine. And His Father is the vine dresser. He is the husband. But every branch, amen, that beareth not fruit, He taketh away. The branches that are taken away, again, I say, were never properly abiding in the vine. Didn't say they were not connected. They were not properly abiding. In other words, when you abide in Christ, you say what God has you to say. The Bible is nothing for us to debate because it is the infallible word of God. So we don't sit around debating scripture because what God says is what God meant. The branches that are taken away were never properly abiding in the vine. Demonstrated by the fact, and as a result, they did not bear fruit. If you are properly, if you are appropriately attached and abiding in the true vine, you will bear fruit. There is an alternative understanding of this passage that bears some consideration. Some believe that the ancient Greek verb arrow, A-I-R-O, translated takes away, is more accurately translated lifts up. The idea is that the Father lifts up unproductive vines off of the ground, as was common in the ancient practices of the vineyard care. Those caring for ancient grapevines must make sure to lift them up off the ground, that they might get some more sun and bear fruit better. And so we're going to take it as we understand it in the spiritual. Those that did not bear fruit, God will lift them up so that perhaps they will get some more sunlight so that they can produce more fruit. Amen. That's what God will do. Amen. God will send the word because it's not His will for you not to be bearing fruit. It's not His will for you to be unproductive. And so God will send word, amen, whether it be through a preacher, whether it be, amen, through, amen, just a loved one, amen, to uplift us so that we can bear fruit. But if we choose to not bear it, the Bible says that He cuts it off. In other words, we are no longer have that abiding fellowship in Him. Every branch that beareth fruit, on the contrary, those that do not bear fruit, He cuts them off. He takes them away. But those that us to not just be fruit producers, but for us to produce more fruit. So what he will do is he prunes us. He cleans us up. Well, how in the world does God do a thing like that? All right, I'm going to help you understand as we get into the next verse. And as we close for tonight's session, the vine dresser cleans up the fruit bearing vine so that it may bear more fruit. Left to itself, a vine will produce a good deal of unproductive growth. And let me say it again. Left to itself, a vine will produce a good deal of unproductive growth. For maximum fruitfulness, extensive pruning is essential. And if it be painful to bleed, it is worth to wither. Better to be pruned to grow than cut up to burn. Let me say it again. And if it be painful to bleed, it is worse to wither. Better to be pruned to grow than to be cut up to burn. Don't you know an ounce of prevention is better than a pound of cure? In other words, I'd rather, amen, for me to do what I need to do, amen, to duck and dodge these darts that the devil has for me, amen, and to fall into one of these traps. Then I got to allow the Lord to return. That's not God's will. Amen. So if we learn how to walk in the Spirit, if we learn how to stay connected to Him, an ounce of prevention is better than a pound of cure. And then you'd rather eat right, amen, amen, than to get high blood pressure and have to take high blood pressure medication. You ought to want to. At least let me say it like that. Now folks got more time, but they just do what they don't even care about their bodies. Amen. You ought to want to cut back with the starches. Amen. And not have to be a diabetic. Amen. And take insulin. Rather than you, amen, have to be a diabetic. I'm not talking about anybody, but an ounce of prevention is better than a pound of cure. And I'd rather be able to avoid that situation, and then through prevention, than to have to get in it and need some more help. Amen. And so the vine dresser cleans up the fruit bearing vine so that it will bear more fruit. How does God clean us up? How does God, amen, prune us? How does God purge us? The Bible says he purged it that it may bring forth more fruit. This is how I do it. That says in verse 3. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. We are clean. We're cleansed through the word. The work of pruning, of cleansing, had already begun in the disciples that Jesus is speaking to. They had heard and had received much of his teaching and were in some sense clean because of the word. In saying you are already clean, Jesus repeated an idea from earlier in that evening according to the text, that there is an initial cleaning and then a continuing cleaning. As it is in our home, amen, sometimes we do a deep clean where we move furniture around, amen, we clean blinds, amen, we get on, amen, behind the nooks and crannies, we clean baseboards, amen, but most people don't do that every day. Why? Because that's a detailed clean, amen, but you ought to do cleaning, amen, in your home as you should, amen, how often that is, and as is in the natural, so it is in the spiritual. You should be, God does an extensive cleaning, amen, in our lives. And, but the cleaning is not just a one-time thing, but it's an ongoing thing. Why? Because the word cleanses us, and that's how we grow. It's through the word of God. It's a dangerous thing to live in a dirty house. Why? Because you live in a dirty house, bacteria and all types of stuff. Amen. So now when you come, amen, to someone's home, you got to call so they can clean up before you come home. Amen. It ought not be so. You ought to keep your house clean. Amen. As it is in the natural. Amen. When someone comes over, they should have to ask you, can they use your bathroom? Amen. If there's no bathroom, you don't keep it clean. Amen. As it is in the natural, so should it be in the spiritual. We ought to keep a clean house. How do we keep a clean house? We can't keep a clean house by ourselves, but we have to allow the word of God to clean us up. So Jesus says that you're clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. So he says, recall back to your mind that which I've already said. The word of God is a cleansing agent. It condemns sin. It inspires holiness. And it promotes growth. Let me say it again. The word of God is a cleansing agent. It condemns sin. Amen. That's why we don't play patty cake with sin. Amen. Because sin, amen, will keep you longer than you want, amen, than you need to, and it'll take you where you don't want to go. Amen. But it condemns sin. It inspires holiness. It promotes growth. And it reveals power for victory. Jesus continues to watch his people through the word. According to Ephesians 5 and 26, the means by which pruning, and I'm coming to a close, coming in. The means by which pruning or cleaning is done is by the word of God. Will not cleanse you through what someone has to say. Will not cleanse you what somebody thought. But we're cleansed through the word of God. The word of God, it condemns sin. It inspires holiness. And it promotes growth. As Jesus applied the words God gave him to the lives of his disciples, they underwent a pruning process that removed evil from them and conditioned them for further service. Jesus says that I am the true vine. My Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it. Ain't it not strange when God purges and prunes you to be what he would have you to be? This walk with Christ is not about what we want to be. But it's about what the Lord would have us to be. And when we allow our will to be lost, to be surrendered in his will, we grow. Pruning is not a comfortable thing. When God prunes you, when God cleanses you, amen, when God begins to deal with you, it is not always a comfortable feeling. And this is why we cannot base our relationships, our walks with Christ, off of a feeling. But we must base it off of being rooted and wanting to have and be in the right position as it relates with God. Amen. Thus, we'll end our lesson on tonight. We pray that you have been blessed by the word of God. Staying connected to the vine is uttermost important. And it's our sincere desire and prayer that you are connected to the vine. Amen. And that you allow yourself to take inventory. Whether or not you're bringing forth fruit. And if you're not bearing fruit, to allow yourself to get back in correct stance and fellowship with God so that you can bear more fruit. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. We indebted to you on tonight. We thank you for the power, the gift of your word. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. Leads and guides us into all truth. And Lord, we ask for your sincere help, your strength. And God, we ask for your might. Help us, Lord, to continue to stay connected. Lord, we don't ever want to be disconnected. We don't want to be attached to, amen, false vines. We don't want to be connected to imitating vines, but we want to be connected to the true vine.
And God, we thank you that you said in your word that you are the true vine. Help us to stay connected to you. Help us to abide. Help us to abide in you. That, Lord, will not just bear or bear fruit. That, Lord, will bear much fruit. For, God, we know that you want us to be fruitful and not fruitless. Bless every listener under the sound of my voice. Bless every need and concern that they, your listeners and your people may have. God, allow no flesh to glory in your sight, but God, you be pleased with things that we say and do. God, if it's your will, we look for you to bring us back together for another opportunity. But Lord, if you crack the sky, we want to hear you say, well done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. God keep you as our prayer. Amen. Tune in. Lord's willing, we'll see you same time next week.